Brothers and sisters of the AHEPA family, good afternoon and a warm welcome to our third presentation of our series of educational webinars, 2020-2021 Lessons from Greece. Thank you all for joining us virtually today from many different places of Canada, Europe, and Greece. We are grateful for your attendance. These webinars are hosted by the District Lodge of Beaver District 23 of Canada, of the Daughters of Penelope. Our webinars cover a wide spectrum of topics ranging from geopolitical dynamics to social concerns to modern city structure and development, and they serve as a cultural and educational bridge between Greece and Greeks abroad, δηλαδή από δημος ελληνισμός. I'm Dr. Ξανθή Βαφοπούλου, the district governor, accompanied by the members of the district lodge, who I would like now to present to you. Lieutenant Governor Angela Muriopoulos, Secretary Roula Maginas Koumoutsidis, raise your hand. Treasurer Betty Drakondaidis, Advisor to the Mage of Athena Katerina Dimou, Advisor to the Daughters of Penelope Annie Valkanas, and Vice President of Scholarships and Public Relations, our great Fotini Karayanis. And she's going to be the Zoom host of our webinar today. I would like also to thank all our guests from Greece, District Governors Linda Belba and Kathy Matrakas, past Canadian Presidents of the Daughters of Penelope, Sister Eleni Inglis, Terry Efston, and Betty Drakondaidis. And if I forgot anybody else, please forgive me, because I'm really excited today that I see such a good crowd to attend this particular webinar. I'm excited to introduce to you our guest speaker today, Mr. Ioannis Chatzis, a historian and public lecturer in Balkan history and Greek foreign policy in the Balkans. Mr. Chatzis studied history at the Aristotelian University of Thessaloniki and holds a master's degree in history of the Balkan Peninsula regarding Greek-Albanian relations in late 19th to early 20th centuries. He has been giving public lectures on these topics for the past 7 years and has been invited to participate in numerous series of the Open University of Thessaloniki and other cities. He has successfully participated in the Meeting for the History and Perspectives of Macedonia, and was honored for his presentation. Mr. Chatzis has submitted several proposals to members of the current Greek parliament concerning Greek foreign policy and the fundamental principles of building a modern state. Today, Mr. Chatzis will talk about the complexity of the relationship between Greece and Albania, with focus on the time period of late 19th century to 20th century. His talk is titled Greek-Albanian Relations, Historic Roots of Current Issues. The idea of Megali Ellada in relation to the integration of Northern Epirus to Greece, where there is the ancient homeland of Vorio Epirotes, will also be examined. Before I invite Mr. Chatzis to speak, I would like Sister Betty to deliver to us a good message from Professor Yannis Chrysolakis from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, who is the Secretary General for Public Diplomacy and Greeks Abroad. Sister Betty, unmute yourself, please.
This is going to be in Greek because Mr. Chrysolakis sent it in Greek, okay? Αγαπητή Πρόεδρε, κύριε Καθηγητά, αγαπητές αδερφές και αδερφοί. Επιτρέψτε μου ειδικά σήμερα να στείλω το μήνυμά μου και όχι να σας μιλήσω απευθείας όπως συνηθίζω, καθώς είναι επιβεβλημένο να είμαι συνεχώς διαθέσιμος για επίγοντα υπηρεσιακά θέματα αυτές τις μέρες. Το καθήκον λοιπόν με υποχρεώνει να βρίσκομαι μακριά σας σήμερα, όμως υπόσχομαι ότι θα παραβρεθώ στην αμέσως επόμενη και εξίσου ενδιαφέρουσα εκδήλωσή σας. Ειδικά οι αδερφές του Καναδά και του Μόντρεαλ με τις ξεχωριστές ευαισθησίες και τις αμέτρητες φιλανθρωπικές και πολιτιστικές δράσεις, είστε οι άνθρωποι που όλοι θέλουμε συνοδοιπόρους στις δικές μας προσπάθειες για την ένωση του ελληνισμού παγκοσμίως, για τη διάδοση των ελληνικών ιδεωδών και αξιών, για την ελληνόγλωση εκπαίδευση και την ελληνομάθεια, μα πάνω απ' όλα για την ίδια την παιδεία και τον ελληνικό πολιτισμό. Στο πλαίσιο αυτό, επιτρέψτε μου να εξάρω την πρωτοβουλία σας να διοργανώνετε αυτά τα τόσο αξιόλογα webinars. Οι παρουσιάσεις και οι συζητήσεις με τις θεματικές και τους εξαίρετους εισηγητές που πάντα κοσμούν τις εκδηλώσεις σας μας εμπλουτίζουν με περισσότερη γνώση αλλά και μας οθούν σε περαιτέρω αναστοχασμό πάνω στα ζητήματα που τίθονται. Έτσι και σήμερα είμαι σίγουρος ότι θα ακουστούν πολύ ενδιαφέρουσες προσεγγίσεις και θα εξαρθούν επωφελή για όλους τους συμμετέχοντας συμπεράσματα από τη συζήτηση που θα ακολουθήσει. Με τη βεβαιότητα ότι θα συνεχίσετε το ίδιο δυναμικά σε όλη τη διάρκεια και αυτού του έτους που μόλις πριν λίγο καιρό ξεκίνησε, σας χαιρετώ από τη Γενική Γραμματεία Δημόσιας Διπλωματίας και Απόδημου Ελληνισμού και ανυπομονώ να σας συναντήσω ξανά ηλεκτρονικά και σύντομα και φυσικά διαζώσεις, μόλις το επιτρέψουν οι υγειονομικές συνθήκες. Καλή επιτυχία και καλή δύναμη.
Ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ, Sister Betty, first of all, because you became the link between the District Lodge and the District and your chapter and Mr. Chrysoulakis, and we thank him very much for his encouraging and supporting words. So thank you very much. And now I would like to invite our honored guest speaker, Mr. Chatzis, to begin his talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Να πω στα ελληνικά πρώτα απ' όλα ότι έχω γραπτό κείμενο μπροστά μου. Θα σας διαβάζω δηλαδή από γραπτό κείμενο, όπως κάνω πάντα, να υπάρχει ένας μπούσουλας, γιατί είναι αρκετά τα θέματα και όταν έχεις γραπτό κείμενο είναι πολύ καλύτερο να τα έχεις καταγεγραμμένα, είναι πολύ καλύτερο ίσως και για τον ομιλητή, αλλά και για τους ακροατές. Well, ladies and gentlemen, fellow guests, I would like to thank for the invitation I was given to take part in the series of webinars lessons from Greece, the District 23 Daughters of Penelope in Canada, as well as each of you individually for participating. You already know the title of today's lecture, the duration of which is 45 minutes, approximately. Tonight we are going to discuss some fundamental issues that someone could undoubtedly argue that affected the future developments concerning Greek-Albanian relations, but also hold the value of their own, as long as historical issues in the Balkan Peninsula, as well as that specific issue, indeed, have a special interest and can be enlightening about a series of things, such as policy making and implementation, also identity issues, but also about the role of the great powers and their weakness, sometimes, to realize the complex nature of Balkan issues. Due to limited time, as well as the nature of the issue to be discussed, we will try to refer to a few basic matters, as well as some things more or less unknown, nevertheless interesting enough, with our aim being in the end of this lecture, everyone to have gained something, either being familiar to that issue or not. We in advance mention that the time period lies the core of the time period to be discussed is that of 1878 to 1914. Because during this period, the most characteristic period of Greek-Albanian relations, and for me personally, the most interesting and with no doubt the most revealing period, full of topics to be examined. What gives a special interest in that period of Greek-Albanian relations, late 19th, early 20th century, lies in the fact that in the general context of trying to expand care territory, liberating Greeks living still under Ottoman rule, Greece was in a position due a series of factors more favorable theoretically to integrate the Christian populations of Epirus, Greeks, Albanian Orthodox, Vlachs, than it was her position, for example, in Macedonia. We will see where it ended up this effort just before the outbreak of World War I. Well, beginning with the examination of the period mentioned already, we have to state in advance that Greece, the Greek government, was obliged to discuss each time with prominent representatives of the Albanian national movement. Since there was not such a thing as a collective institution representing the Albanians, which the Greek side could come to terms with. Talking about the Albanian national movement, we should keep in mind that within the frameworks of the Ottoman Empire, the priority of religion over ethnic consciousness meant that the Muslim Albanian majority had accomplished a de jure superior position compared to the position of their Christian, Orthodox, and Catholic compatriots, as well as compared to the position of the Christian element of the Ottoman Empire in general. Consequently, a substantial number of Muslim Albanians had managed to obtain high positions in the Ottoman Empire. That reality, as a series of other facts, contributed to the delayed appearance of the Albanian national movement, which basically comes to historical stage in 1878. And for that reason, we choose 1878 as the starting point of the period to be discussed. After one more Eastern crisis, the third, 1875 to 1878, as a result of the Russo-Turkish War, the Ottoman Empire was obliged to cede territories to Montenegro and Greece. In those lands to be ceded, ethnic Albanians were lived among the others, who opposed to that settlement, and so in the city of in Kosovo region, a league was formed, the so-called League of Prizren, that is considered as the appearance of Albanian nationalism or Albanian ethnic consciousness. The main goal of the League of Prizren was to preserve the status quo in Western Balkans and to cancel the cession of lands to Montenegro and Greece, as it had been decided by the Congress of Berlin, by the great powers. Another declared aim of the League of Prizren was the defending of the rights of the Albanian people who inhabited the four vilayets. Vilayet is a form of administrative unit in the Ottoman Empire. So the vilayets of Shkodra, Monastir, Kosovo, and Janina. From the very beginning, a certain amount of concern and disbelief was created about the League of Prizren on behalf of the Greek, but also the European side, upon the question whether the creation of the League was based on genuine patriotic sentiments by the Albanians, or it was a diplomatic maneuver of Turkey aiming at delaying or even cancel the territorial cessions that had been decided by the Congress of Berlin. A quite neutral look cannot but come to the conclusion that the League was truly a patriotic Albanian organization. Its motives were patriotic in an Albanian point of view, while even if the League's goals coincided with those of Ottoman Empire, nevertheless, when the League was self-appointed as provisional government of Albania, Turkey was forced to disband it using military force. A naval cruising to the Adriatic Sea and the threat of intervention on behalf of the great powers' navy had contributed greatly to persuade Turkey to attack the Albanian insurgents and cede the decided territory to Montenegro. In that point, let's keep in our mind that the great powers asked pressure and nearly intervened to force Turkey to cede lands in the north. The critical role of the Albanian north in Albanian affairs will also be detected around the end of the period we examine, with the Albanian independence being mainly a result of repeated revolts in the north and not in the south, where till the Albanian independence, the Christian population, mainly Greek, but also Orthodox Albanians, were in majority quite uninterested in the outbreak of Albanian nationalism. Unfortunately, the crucial role of Albanian North, such as was already proven to be so by these events of 1881, didn't seem to be fully understood by the Greek foreign policy, which in the following years continued its efforts to annex Epirus, relied on its traditional advantages in the region, the identification of the Orthodox Albanians with the ecumenical patriarchate, and therefore the little progress of the Albanian national idea among them, as well as the prestige of Greek education, guaranteed by the normal and uninterrupted operation of Greek schools in Epirus and South Albania. It should be noted in that point that many of the leading figures of the Albanian national movement had studied in Greek schools, being granted Greek education. As a conclusion to our reference to the League of Prizren, we have to mention a League's act of special Greek interest. During the Berlin Congress, a memorandum by prominent Albanians of Shkodra region was sent to the British representative in the Congress, Lord Beaconsfield. In that memorandum, those prominent Albanians were referring to the perspective of a kind of alliance between the Albanian factor and Greece, presenting such a perspective as desirable, while in the same time, they opposed the possibility of Greece annexing, annexing a future Albanian state due to deep differences in ethics and customs, as it was said characteristically. Being aware of the deep differences between the Albanians of the North with them of the South, just one of the many causes that contributed to the division of Albanian people and were responsible of their delayed self-consciousness, we shouldn't overestimate the significance of this memorandum, but to consider it as what it was really meant to be, a memorandum coming from the Albanian North and nothing more. At the same time, Albanians of South Albania and Epirus were sending memoranda aiming to prevent the annexation of Farta region and Thessaly by Greece. Finally, Turkey, having, as we saw, been forced to cede lands to Montenegro, granted a relatively small part of the lands to be ceded to Greece, the region of Farta, after long Greek-Turkish negotiations. Concluding our reference to the period 1878 to 1881, we note that this is the period during which the Albanian question came to the fore, because until then, Albania was only a geographical term, as Bismarck, the German chancellor, was stating in a distinctive way. It's also from that period and on that the Greek side starts to foresee the Albanians as a possible ally that could restrain Slavic expansion in the Balkan Peninsula and to form with Greece the deterrent power to Slavism, namely Serbia, which had already achieved independence, and Bulgaria, autonomous and not independent state yet. So, beginning with the last quarter of 19th century, both leading class in Greece, but also many individuals and also press, started taking into consideration some kind of cooperation with the Albanian factor could promote Greek claims to incorporate Epirus in Greece. When the Ottoman rule in Balkans would come to an end, something that seemed to be more and more unavoidable in the turn of the century. The anti-Slavic direction was clearly the groundwork for such a cooperation, and in that context, the indigenousness of both Greeks and Albanians in the Balkan Peninsula was greatly promoted against the Slavs who had come to the Balkans in the Middle Ages. Another realistic argument used by those in favor of a Greek-Albanian understanding, whose number was increasing, were the fighting skills in the wars of Ottoman Empire and the general power of the Albanians, as this power had become evident in the wars of Ottoman Empire, including those wars against Greece. Indeed, Albania, a merely geographical expression in the end of 19th century, had always been considered as the rampart of Ottoman rule in the Western Balkans. And as we have already mentioned, because of the identification of Muslim Albanian majority with the Turkish rule, due to the beneficial status within the Ottoman Empire, Ottoman rule in Epirus and Albanian lands was almost entirely exercised by Muslim Albanians. Muslim majority of the Albanian people is directly connected to the lack of a unified ethnic Albanian education in Albanian schools using the Albanian language, as Muslim Albanian children were attending classes in Turkish schools in Turkish language, while the Catholic Albanian tribes of northern Albania were under the influence of Austria-Hungary, that as early as 1616 had assumed the protection of religious and educational rights of Catholic Albanians after a treaty with the Ottoman Empire. Orthodox Albanian children studied in Greek schools, whose operation was uninterrupted and normal, and also had a broadly recognized prestige. Orthodox Albanian children studying in Greek schools was one of the aspects that had contributed for the Greek view of considering all Orthodox Albanians, notice the contradiction here, as Greeks. That belief has many explanations that rely naturally on the Ottoman practice of including all the Orthodox elements of the empire in the so-called Rum Millet, which had as leader the Patriarch of Constantinople. Therefore, Orthodox Albanians were organically integrated in Rum Millet, and is a reality to a certain point that had partially a kind of Greek identity, at least until the rise of Albanian nationalism, that normally called for the unification of all Albanian people, regardless of their faith, with main bond between them being the Albanian language. Therefore, the paradox which constituted the fact that Greece recognized the Albanian national identity, the same time that all Orthodox Albanians were considered as Greeks, can be explained by the difference between the concepts nationality and identity. All these were happening within the framework of the changes inside the Ottoman Empire, changes that consisted in the evolution of Millet institution into groups defined by other criteria, such as language and national consciousness. Simply, in the case of Epirus and South Albania, the coincidence of Orthodox Albanians with the Ecumenical Patriarchate, the religious division of Albanians into Muslim, Orthodox, Christian, and Catholic Christian, the lack of an ethnic center, of one strong common Albanian tradition that could preserve an identity, and finally, the due to all those factors, delayed rise of Albanian nationalism and spreading of Albanian national idea to wider sections of the populations, made theoretically, as we have already mentioned, the work of the Greek diplomacy regarding the annexation of Epirus easier than that in Macedonia. In Macedonia, Bulgaria especially, after achieving the establishment of an autocephalous Bulgarian church, was a much more difficult opponent for Greek policy, as the Bulgarians was had a not yet independent state to support the adoption of the Bulgarian national identity on behalf of the Orthodox Slavic speaking of Macedonia. In conclusion, on that report on identities in late 19th to early 20th century, we have to mention that in the frequent diplomatic correspondence between the Greek foreign ministry with the Greek embassy at Constantinople, the general consulate of Ioannina, the various Greek consulates in Epirus and Albania, and the Ecumenical Patriarchate of Constantinople, we always come across the term emeteri, that is ours, our people, our population. That term refers to the Greek natives of Epirus, as well as the Albanian Orthodox, as well as to the Albanian Orthodox people, who, as we mentioned, due to their coincidence with the Ecumenical Patriarchate, tended to be identified with the Greek population, included in the Rum Millet. After the Young Turks Revolution in 1908, that situation gradually started to change. Speaking of the official representatives of Greek foreign policy in Epirus and Albania, we should also mention the role of clergy and that of the teachers sent to Greek schools by Greece as unofficial policymakers. If, as it was the case in Macedonia, Greece had to face Bulgarian opposition, in Epirus, as well as in Albania, Greece had to keep a close eye on the developments of the Albanian national movement, but also on acts of propaganda from Italy and Austria-Hungary, two states holding special interests on Adriatic Sea and Albanian affairs. Moreover, even Romania, a Balkan state that had no common boundaries with the region we examine, neither was going to ever head in the event of collapse of Ottoman rule, was trying to attract via propaganda the Vlachs, tus Vlachus, who, however, had a solid Greek national consciousness. Well, that was in general the situation in Epirus and the Albanian lands during the last quarter of 19th century, when the Greek foreign policy, the press, and many individuals started to see in the Albanian factor a possible ally on an anti-Slavic basis. The inherent difficulties for a rapprochement between a state, as that was the case for Greece, with the Albanian element of the Ottoman Empire, that except the common language had not yet realized its own national identity to a satisfactory degree, may could have discouraged those Greeks in favor of the rapprochement. But on the other side, the unstable scene in Western Balkans, as in the whole of the Ottoman Empire, was providing a great freedom of thought about the form that could take an understanding between Greece and the Albanians. The perspective of creating a dual kingdom in the same way as Austria-Hungary represents the most far-reaching plan drawn by those in favor of the understanding. As dual kingdom was considered a state with common international representation, while the two elements, Greeks and Albanians, would be free to decide and act autonomously in sectors as the education and justice. Basically, we're dealing with a plan to create a confederation, which would be realized through the annexation with loose ties to Greece of a future Albanian entity, which was expected to occur after the end of Ottoman rule in the Balkans, which was more and more evident that was to come the next few years. The difficulties of the plan were surely understood, and now we can be very sure that these plans of creating a dual kingdom were in reality a maneuver of Greek diplomacy aiming at affecting the Albanian national movement in such a way that the latter would not be opposed to Greek claims in Epirus, or even better, to align with the Greek point of view about a series of matters, such as the demarcation of the future borders between Greece and the future Albanian identity. The perspective of Greek-Albanian rapprochement was given a substantial and significant boost as a result of association Ellenismos, published a monthly review in the articles of which the arguments and the opinions of those who were in favor of a dual kingdom were often hosted. Neoklis Kazazis, president of Ellenismos Association, had long been in contact with Ismail Kemal, influential figure of the Albanian movement, who had also served in high administrative positions in the Ottoman Empire. In March 1907, the so-called Declaration of Greek-Albanian Understanding was signed in Athens, all along with the accompanying special protocol, in which the basis for the success of the agreement were specified. Undoubtedly, this agreement between the Greek government and an individual, Ismail Kemal, couldn't stand as a permanent arrangement of the Greek-Albanian interests, or to set it better, the demarcation of Epirus borders. Nevertheless, the Greek side was aiming at attracting a prominent Albanian figure to the Greek views, an Albanian leader who was expected to play a leading role in Albanian affairs in the following years, as he really did, with the expectation to be saved a more advantageous position towards Greece, when the difficult matter of border demarcation between Greece and the future Albanian entity would de facto emerge.